you've been sometimes labeled a bad vegan. What does this mean? This is Dr. Danielle Bilardo. She's a vegan and a cardiologist. But oddly enough, she's gotten a lot of flack from the vegan community. Let's find out why. Why is this happening, considering that you're an expert in this field as well as a vegan?
I'm very honest and transparent about the data, which is the truth is you don't have to go 100% vegan to have health benefits by any means. Our American College of Cardiology guidelines, I think, really are the most robust and best data in this space. They essentially say that eating more plants is better than less. Eating a plant-predominant diet or a plant-based diet are both great.
I am glad that you aren't backing down from that message. You are sticking by evidence-based medicine, saying what you know, what we don't know, because there's a lot of that, especially with how really lackluster the research has been thus far in the nutrition space.
Right.
But I think we sort of hyper-focused there right at the outset of being all about health when it comes to being vegan. What does it truly mean to be vegan? Because it's more than just health aspects of it. Am I correct?
Totally. So actually, veganism in itself is not a diet. It's more of an ethical decision. It's just abstaining from animal products and from essentially adding harm to animals in any way practical and possible. So things like, for example, medications that have been tested on animals, vaccines, these are things I do support.
We've all seen the documentaries that preach doom and gloom that say if you eat one egg a day, that's equivalent to some horrendous habit like smoking. What's your reaction when you hear something like that?
I think that we could do a lot more as vegan physicians, and there's a small growing amount of us that are doing this, but we could do a lot more in general if we kept our messaging about nutrition science really honest, right? I don't need to convince people to go vegan by cherry picking data or really extrapolating things from nutrition science that aren't there. Nowadays, we want to get your LDL cholesterol as low as possible for cardiovascular risk prevention, so primary prevention versus also secondary prevention. So how do we do that? Well, we want to reduce saturated fat, and a lot of that's in animal products. And in a whole egg, there is saturated fat. If you have high cholesterol, eating multiple eggs a day, adding more saturated fat into your diet, probably not beneficial. But, you know, we just want to lower the overall saturated fat that a patient's eating to help reduce their cholesterol.
Now, the research that we have from elevated LDL scores then matching to outcomes, meaning patients actually getting a heart attack as a first time, getting a secondary heart attack, even losing their lives. Do we feel that those end results are correlated to the LDL scores of people who are eating those saturated food products and living a very unhealthy lifestyle with that?
So starting with what we know even on these metabolic ward studies, the link between saturated fat and raising LDL cholesterol is so well demonstrated. It's been demonstrated in metabolic ward studies for years and years. Like hundreds of studies have shown us that raising your LDL cholesterol by eating saturated fat it's predictable in a linear fashion. You can also help to lower your LDL cholesterol by eating fiber. And the only thing that fiber is in is plants. One of the things that we also have the most robust research for in cardiology history is the predictability of LDL cholesterol being causative in atherosclerosis. So atherosclerosis is when essentially you start to have your vessels start to harden because you have plaque buildup. And actually all of us start to develop atherosclerosis even when we're young. It's just how bad it builds up while you get older. When people have other risk factors, so things like they're a smoker or they have diabetes or they have high blood pressure, that makes them actually more at risk for cardiovascular disease because the endothelial lining, so the lining of the arteries, ends up becoming weaker and more damaged. And so that LDL cholesterol can really get in there and cause worse plaque.
I see a difference in that if someone can have an LDL of 90 versus if they raise their LDL by introducing, let's say, one egg a day or chicken into their lifestyle, and now it goes up to 110. Have we seen the difference between a 90 and a 110 in the form of primary prevention? Or is it solely if they go extreme and introduce a lot of saturated fats, go full keto, that you start seeing the 190s, 200s figures?
For anyone listening that doesn't understand the difference, so primary prevention is preventing heart disease before you have a cardiac event, so a heart attack or something like that. Secondary prevention is preventing a heart attack when someone has already had a heart event, so whether it's a stroke or they already have underlying cardiovascular disease. For LDL targets in primary prevention, the more and more data that's coming out, we really want your lifetime exposure of LDL to be as low as possible. So I would say, yes, you want your, in someone without heart disease and without other risk factors, keep your LDL below 100. And if it's the difference between 100 or 110 or, you know, 90, it's not quite significant. And then where it really matters is also in secondary prevention. You know, now the ESC guidelines, so the European Society of Cardiology, they're a little ahead of us with ACC. Now, for secondary prevention, we want our patients' LDL less than 55.
The conversation that happens online the most is usually surrounding the primary prevention aspect, yep. In that, like, I'm a healthy person, I eat some protein, chicken, fish, etc. Am I increasing my risk? And when I think about this, I am not a cardiologist, you are. So not that I'm saying you don't think holistically. To me, I have to balance so many risks for this patient in their everyday life that I have to sort of pick my battles as to which risk is gonna be the biggest risk, mm-hmm. because I can't give someone 10 things to change in their life and really be honestly expecting for all these things to happen, especially when it comes to food. Food holds such an important part in culture, in society, mm-hmm. in manners. So I have to tread lightly when I'm giving this type of advice. And that's why I'm trying to figure out how much of a battle should I make it and where should it fall on the priority scheme?
So one important point you just made, which is that I emphasize always, is that we have to meet patients where they're at. There is no all or nothing. Patients don't have to go 100% plant-based or 100% Mediterranean. Literally, small changes count. And the reason why that's not popular in social media is because everyone wants to sell a diet as a cure-all and as the only way, because they want their diet book to sell, when in reality, the truth is somewhere in between, right? The philosophy I live by is I just present my patients with the options and the data, and then I'm there to support them in any way I can help them.
Do you think there are any health benefits to consuming meat or fish?
Red meat, I absolutely think there's no health benefits. We actually have an American College of Cardiology recommendation that's official recommendation to limit or eliminate red meat. Lean meats are actually recommended with our ACC guidelines. So what's my opinion on lean meat? Do I think that you need them or that they add benefit to your health? Personally, no. I think that anyone who's interested in the literature in this, if you look at Ron Krauss, did a study, he did a phenomenal study actually. He did a randomized control trial that was a crossover study, and people were randomized to either red meat, white meat, or plant protein. And he actually controlled for saturated fat. And he looked at LDL cholesterol, and then he actually crossed them over to each of the other arms. And what did he find? That actually red meat and white meat, when he controlled for saturated fat, actually raised cholesterol, the LDL cholesterol, equally. And the only thing that didn't was the plant protein. Now, fish is a different story. So we have consistent epidemiological research that shows us that fish is beneficial. Fatty fish is beneficial with cardiovascular disease. Some studies showing us it's neutral. So to me, you could go either way. And the truth is that with all of these foods, you can eat all of them. Like, you never need to feel that you can eat nothing ever again. It's just trying to modify your overall dietary pattern to a healthful one.
Would you say that we have complete data to say that elimination of all animal products is undoubtedly safe and ideal for all?
I'll start with safe. Mm-hmm. Is eliminating 100% animal products safe for all? 100% yes. So there is absolutely, we need absolutely nothing from animals, despite what people will tell you. We can supplement B12. The American Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics even has an official formal statement that it's actually healthy to be vegan. It's gotta be a well-planned plant-based diet is helpful at all stages of life. We're talking infancy through adulthood. We have randomized control trial data showing that plant-based diets are healthful, but also we also have epidemiological data. Even if you look at the seven-day Adventists, right? They're some of the longest living people in the world. If you look at the blue zones, and they eat 100%, you know, plant-based diet. Now, your second question was, is that ideal? And this is where I get some people give me a hard time. You do not have to go on 100% plant-based diet to be in ideal health and be healthful. We don't have data that shows that eating 100% plant-based diet is better than eating a really plant-centered or plant-predominant diet with some amount of animal products.
There's certain blue zones that do eat animal products, certain ones that don't. It's important to know that individuals cross-culturally have developed different abilities to extract energies from food, different reactions to certain foods. Their gut microbiome is totally different, which is a whole new thing that we're exploring. For me, I like to be introspective and think about how we need to be very humble when it comes to even looking at evidence and medicine. And you know, you've talked a lot about of great data of you know, outcomes for primary prevention, secondary prevention, increasing LDL scores when you eat animal products. We've also seen, this is historically speaking, very historically speaking, humans started eating animal products at some point in our prehistoric nature. There's been some data showing and speculating perhaps at times that the reason we've gotten taller, the reasons our minds evolved, because we started eating animal products.
I do think people extrapolate way too much from historic, you know, things in general. People were really truly, you know, more gatherers than they were hunters, and eating lots of plants. Of course, there are certain populations like the Inuit who eat a high fat diet and they do fine with it. So from the evolutionary standpoint, I do not think we need or require animal products to be healthy.
Do you feel like there's a heavy user bias that exists with, like, you have people who follow a vegan lifestyle are generally healthier, they're less likely to smoke, less likely to engage in bad habits, getting a poor amount of sleep, mental health struggles, etc., than compared to someone who's eating the American standard diet. There was one study where they compared vegetarians to their friends who ate meat but followed similar lifestyle habits, and then people who shopped at similar health food stores who ate animal products and those who didn't. And they found actually their endpoints were quite similar. Do you feel like there's something to be made of this?
So healthy user bias is a real thing. It could be, you look at the 7-day Adventists, but this is what's interesting is that we actually have data with hard outcomes that totally eliminates that. So if you actually look at what I mentioned again, randomized controlled trial, right? Leo and Hart, they decreased butter, decreased saturated fat, decreased red meat, increased fruits, vegetables, whole grains, legumes. And the experimental group had more smokers, and they still had improved cardiac outcomes just from what they ate, just from eating more plants and less animal products. And it was not a vegan diet. It was just a Mediterranean style plant forward diet. Another randomized controlled trial was PrediMed. And if you looked at the post hoc analysis of the PrediMed data, the post, the vegetarian subgroup actually had the most reduction in cardiovascular mortality as well.
I think there's such an important distinction to be made between population evidence and an individual guidance.
Yes.
Because it's incredible how many patients I have come through my door that if I even give the best knowledge of all these references that you've mentioned, to think that they're gonna adapt it right away is not realistic. So when I don't, I can see how the vegan community can come after me and say, in one of my videos, I recommended, I said, like, we should eliminate as much as we can processed foods.
I totally agree.
Including, you know, like hot dogs out of our diet.
Yeah.
But if you go to a ball game and you eat a hot dog to celebrate that you're at a ball game.
I totally agree.
But I got destroyed on that. Like,
but I totally agree with you. Like, no one food in one dose is going to cause disease. If you eat birthday cake, if you eat a steak, you know, once in a while, like, no one food in one dose is going to cause a problem.
Do you think for a patient who is diagnosed with obesity or morbid obesity, do you think it's more important for this patient to look at their caloric intakes or more important to look at the types of foods they're consuming?
I think it depends. So at my practice, we have registered dietitians medicines, and we have obesity medicine specialty. So we do a multidisciplinary approach. Some patients who are obese or have morbid obesity, some patients benefit from gastric bypass surgery. Like, the best data we have is actually no specific dietary pattern is actually gastric bypass surgery. The results are remarkable. And so I think a multi-pronged approach is important. When it comes to the dietary portion of it, you know, if you look at the data of what people can sustain, we have research showing that people can stay on keto for 2 years. We have research showing you can stay on plant-based for 2 years. We have research showing that you could do whatever. I think it's most important to work with a registered dietitian and find something that works for you. If that's small changes, and sometimes people, I'm sure you see this in your practice too, sometimes patients can do unbelievably well just cutting out soda.
Last point here, it's something that you've mentioned before you struggled with. There's an unfortunate tie-in that has developed in the natural foods community and has now reached into the vegan community as well, surrounding being anti-vaccine. Talk me through how that's come about and how do you speak to that subject?
The one thing that has unified nutrition Twitter this year is that there's a huge presence of anti-vax. And I think that all of us who are physicians in this space who are not anti-vax like me have kind of all bonded over this fact. And I think it all comes down to the same thing. There's this inaccurate belief that health is just a pull yourself up by your bootstraps method, and that everyone should be able to just fix their health immediately with their own willpower, not respecting the fact that each individual has certain circumstances that maybe make it more difficult for them to lose weight or follow a certain dietary pattern, etc. And so part of this whole idea that people in some of these diet groups have is that this pull yourself up by your bootstraps mentality is that, well, COVID isn't a big deal and that we don't need vaccines. And then also in the natural health community, there's obviously a ton of misinformation about what vaccines are, what they do to you, that they change your DNA. And so to me, the most important thing to emphasize to my patients, and I do this with everything from vaccines to statins to diabetes medication, is that this binary idea that it has to be lifestyle or medicine, to me, is where we got it wrong.
As the expert, I'd like to leave you with the final word here. Take us through what you find to be the optimal diet for us to follow, and how should we be thinking about nutrition and health into the future?
There is no perfect diet. Chasing the perfect diet's a fallacy. I think that just focusing on the overall context of your dietary pattern, meaning eating more plants, so more fruits, vegetables, whole grains, legumes, nuts, and seeds, you know, limiting red meat, processed foods, these things can be beneficial. And just looking at the overall context of your dietary pattern, I think that's the best that we can say from the data we have overall is most important.
I actually went vegan for 30 days and a whole bunch of other diets. Click here to check it out. And as always, stay happy and healthy.